In the history of the Olympic Games, there have been many magnificent athletes whose performances will live for all time. Four men and women in particular are unique for their achievements, yet they are comparatively unknown. Irena, Szewinska, Poland. Pat McCormick, United States. Klaus Dibiasi, Italy. Harrison Dillard, United States. This is the story of the rare ones. Olympiads. When women's track and field was first introduced to the Olympics at the 1928 Amsterdam Games, Betty Robinson of the United States, second from the left, became the first woman gold medal winner when she won the 100 meters. She did not compete at the Los Angeles Games, but 8 years later in Berlin, Betty Robinson ran the third leg on the victorious United States 4x100 relay team. Betty Robinson won two gold medals 8 years apart. At the 1956 Melbourne Games, Betty Cuthbert of Australia won gold medals in the 100 meters, 200 meters, and 4x100 relay. Injuries prevented Betty Cuthbert from making it to the finals at the 1960 Rome Olympic Games. But 4 years later in Tokyo, she enters the 400 meters. Betty Cuthbert wins. Like Betty Robinson before her, Betty Cuthbert won Olympic gold medals 8 years apart. This is Warsaw, Poland, the home of Irena Kirchenstein-Szewinska. She began her Olympic career at the age of 18 at the 1964 Tokyo Olympic Games. There she won silver medals in the 200 meters and long jump, and a gold medal as a member of the victorious Polish 4x100 relay team. She had begun one of the longest and most illustrious careers in Olympic track and field history. Today she is the only woman to have won Olympic gold medals 12 years apart. Marching with the Polish team, 22-year-old Irena Szewinska. After the Tokyo Games, she studied economics at Warsaw University and was married to Janusz Szewinsk, a Polish sports photographer. Here in Mexico City, she continues to compete under her maiden name, Irena Kirschenstein. She will compete in four events.
Things started badly for me in Mexico City. I did not qualify for the long jump final, and my second event was the 100 meters, which is not my favorite event. Because of my height, I'd always start poorly, and by the time I'd be in full stride, the race was over.
Irena Kirschenstein is second from the left in red shorts. The favorite in the race is defending Olympic champion Wyomi Atias of the United States on the extreme right.
I knew that my top competition was going to come from Barbara Farrell and Kirschenstein and Raylene Boyle. I knew that Barbara was going to get out the blocks, and if I was anywhere close to her, I was going to be, you know, it was going to be like, you know, neck and neck for Barbara now. And I knew Kirschenstein was going to be coming. She was going to be there, and you were going to hear her footsteps, because she's 5'11", about 130, and she had the long strides. And you knew she was going to be there, and I kept saying, if I get out, I'm gone. And if, you know, at 80 meters, I don't care where she is, I, you know, I can see that tape, and I'm going to win this thing.
Wyomi Atias first, Barbara Farrell second, Irena Kirschenstein third. October 15th, 1968, the final of the 200 meters. Irena Kirschenstein is the world record holder in this event. However, in her semi-final heat, she finishes third as Raylene Boyle of Australia sets a new Olympic record, just 0.2 seconds behind Irena's world record.
The field was a very strong one. I would be facing four of the competitors I ran against in the 100 meters, Raylene Boyle of Australia and the three Americans, Wyomi Atias, Barbara Farrell, and Margaret Bales.
Wyomi Atias, third from the right, is out first. Irena Kirschenstein, on the right, in the red shorts, is again slow to start. She is in seventh place. Now Irena Kirschenstein starts to move. Irena Kirschenstein first. Raylene Boyle second. Jennifer Lemmy, Australia third. Irena Kirschenstein has set a new world and Olympic record. A few days later, in the semi-final heat of the 4x100 relay, the defending champions from Poland are eliminated from competition. Because of a bad pass-off, Irena drops the baton. Nevertheless, in two Olympiads, Irena Kirschenstein has won 2 gold, 2 silver, and 1 bronze medal. Munich, 1972. Competing under her married name, Szewinska, 26-year-old Irena once more makes the Polish team in three events. Between the Mexico City and Munich games, her son Andrzej was born. A year before the games, she severely injured her ankle, and it was slow to heal. She is forced to withdraw from the long jump and does not qualify in the 100-meter final.
The Munich Games was really the beginning of my second career. After Andrzej was born in 1970, I did not train for a year. And coming back again after so long a time is very difficult. However, I gained confidence in the heats of the 200 meters. I won 2 of the heats and came in third in the semifinals, but I had the best time of any of the 8 finalists.
The favorites in the 200 meters, however, were still Renata Stecher of East Germany and Raylene Boyle of Australia. Stecher has won the 100-meter gold medal and Boyle the silver. Szewinska in red shorts is in lane 5 in the middle. Renata Stecher is in lane 6 to her right, and Raylene Boyle in lane 4 to her left. Coming out of the turn, Stecher leads, Boyle second, Szewinska third. Re- Renata Stescher first. Raylene Boyle second. Irena Szewinska third. For the third successive Olympiad, Irena has won a medal. Her total is now 2 gold, 2 silver, and 2 bronze medals in 3 Olympiads. Irena Szewinska returns to Poland. She is now 26 years old. She continues to enter national and international competitions. In 1973, Irena and Janusz Szewinsk made 2 decisions. Janusz would become her coach, and Irena would compete in a new event, the 400 meters. Just 2 years after she first attempted the 400 meters, Irena became the first woman in history to run that distance under 50 seconds.
Through the many years of training, Irena had built up a tremendous amount of endurance. As she got older, her speed in the 200 meters was increasing, not decreasing. Therefore, it was logical that her natural speed combined with her endurance would make the 400 meters the ideal distance for her.
Montreal, 1976. Irena Szewinska, for the 4th straight Olympiad, marches in the opening day ceremonies with the team from Poland. She will compete in only one event, the 400 meters. She is the holder of the world record. Only one other woman has ever run the distance under 50 seconds. She is 18-year-old Christina Bremer of East Germany. In her 2 qualifying heats, Irena Szewinska barely qualifies, finishing 3rd and 4th. But in her semi-final, she sets a new Olympic record. July 29th, the final of the 400 meters. Irena Szewinska is in lane 4 in the middle of the track. In this lane, she is in perfect position to observe the 7 other runners in the race. Christina Bremer of East Germany will be to her left in lane 2. Rosalind Bryant of the United States will be to her right in lane 7. These are the 2 runners Irena Szewinska fears. Both have qualified easily in their previous races. The runners will race once around the 400 meter track. Because of the staggered lanes, it will be difficult to see who is in front until they straighten out after the final turn. Christina Bremer, 2nd from the left, goes out quickly. As they go down the backstretch, Bremer of East Germany leads. Rosalind Bryant of the United States on the left is 2nd. Szewinska in red shorts in the middle now starts to move. Into the final turn, Szewinska is going fastest of all. Coming off the final turn, Szewinska in the middle goes out in front. Irena Szewinska, Poland, 1st. Christina Bremer, East Germany, 2nd. Irena Szewinska has set a new world and Olympic record. 12 years after her first gold medal, the Polish national anthem is again played for Irena Szewinska. In 4 Olympiads, she has won 3 gold, 2 silver, and 2 bronze medals. One of the greatest individual performances in the history of the Olympic Games. This is Sammy Lee of the United States. Competing at the 1948 London and 1952 Helsinki Olympic Games, he became the first man in history to win the Olympic platform diving gold medal twice. This is Bob Webster of the United States. At the 1960 Rome and 1964 Tokyo Games, he duplicated Sammy Lee's feat of winning the platform diving gold medal in successive Olympics. This is Klaus Dibiasi of Italy. He retired after the 1976 Montreal Games at the age of 29 after competing in four Olympiads. Klaus Dibiasi is today considered the greatest platform diver in history. Tokyo, 1964. The opening day ceremonies of the Olympic Games. Marching with the team from Italy, 17-year-old Klaus Dibiasi. Marching with the team from the United States, 26-year-old Bob Webster, defending Olympic champion in platform diving.
We had not heard much from the foreign divers at all in 1964 because it had almost been an all-American kind of a monopoly in tower diving. He had won the European championships in 64, but we really were not aware of him. That was the first time, of course, I'd met Klaus. And, you know, the old adage that nice guys finish last, well, that just doesn't apply to Klaus. I don't know anyone that would say anything bad against him, has any animosity towards him at all. He's a complete, true gentleman, a credit to the human race, or whatever you want, any kind of thing you want to describe this man, he is the best.
Klaus Dibiasi is coached by his father, Carlo, four-time Italian national diving champion. Another American in the competition in Tokyo is Tom Gompf.
There was a unique relationship between Klaus and his father. You know, it's very difficult for a father to coach his son, but they did it with such great dignity. Everybody loved Carlo as much as they loved Klaus.
The Tokyo platform diving competition gets underway. 17-year-old Klaus Dibiasi goes into the lead early and stays in first place throughout most of the competition. But with two dives left, Dibiasi falters. Bob Webster in third place now has an opening. Webster is near perfect. He moves past Dibiasi into first place. Now Dibiasi and Webster each have one dive left. Dibiasi scores well on his 10th and last dive. The pressure is now on Webster. He must score equally well to maintain his lead. Webster is again near perfect. For the second successive Olympiad, he has won the platform diving gold medal. Klaus Dibiasi second. Tom Gompf, United States third. Klaus Dibiasi has won the first medal ever won by an Italian diver in Olympic competition. He now looks forward to the 1968 Games in Mexico City.
Between 64 and 68, I won a lot of meetings and won European Championship, but my biggest ambition was to win the Olympic Games.
Mexico City, 1968, the opening day ceremonies of the 19th Olympiad of the modern era. 21-year-old Klaus Dibiasi is now the finest platform diver in the world. Two-time Olympic champion Bob Webster has retired. Dibiasi is the favorite to win the gold medal. The competition gets underway. Alvaro Gaxiola, the Mexican champion, is expected to give Dibiasi his main opposition. Gaxiola performs well throughout the competition, but here in Mexico City, Klaus Dibiasi is in a class by himself. He wins the gold medal by one of the largest margins since the event began 64 years before, at the St. Louis Games of 1904. double gold medal winner Dr. Sammy Lee was a witness to the competition.
It wasn't so much competition for Klaus Dibiasi, except for that the crowd, the Mexican crowd, was intimidating the judges, and they had to hold up the competition half hour because they're yelling and screaming because they thought that Gaxiola, who won the silver medal, should have gotten more points. But I myself thought he should have gotten lesser points. I remember going around to the side there to congratulate Papa Dibiasi. And like all coaches, when their divers win a gold medal, the tears just flow from your eyes.
After the Mexico City Games, Klaus Dibiasi and his father returned to their home in Bolzano, Italy. Thousands of people from neighboring towns came to greet him. Now Klaus Dibiasi has another goal: to join Bob Webster and Dr. Sammy Lee as the only men to win successive gold medals in Olympic platform diving. Munich, 1972. The nations of the world again parade in the 20th renewal of the modern Olympic Games. Klaus Dibiasi is now 24 years old. When the diving competition gets underway, it is obvious from the beginning that the battle will be for second place. Klaus Dibiasi is far superior to the rest of the divers of the world. There is no question that the gold medal is his. When the competition is over, Klaus Dibiasi wins by a greater margin than he did 4 years before in Mexico City. It is the greatest margin in Olympic history. For the second time in Olympic diving competition, the Italian national anthem is played. Now Klaus Dibiasi has one final goal: to become the only man in Olympic history to win three successive diving gold medals. Klaus Dibiasi continued to excel in the years leading to the 1976 Montreal Games. In 1974, he won the European Championships. The following year, he won his second World Championship. Back in the United States, a new platform and springboard diving star is on the rise. His name, Greg Louganis. Louganis is 16 years old and has never competed in a major international event. At the United States Olympic Trials, Louganis amazed the diving world by winning the competition easily and was twice awarded the score of 10 for perfect dives. Montreal, 1976. For the first time in three Olympiads, the platform diving competition is expected to be very close right through the final dives. For the first time since Bob Webster defeated him 12 years before, Klaus Dibiasi's victory is in jeopardy.
In Montreal happened the same thing as happened in Tokyo, 1964, between Bobby Webster and me. Webster was the old man, he was 29 in Tokyo and I was 17. And now in Montreal, same thing happened again between me and Louganis. I was the old man and Louganis was the young boy.
In the early part of the final round, Greg Louganis leads. Klaus Dibiasi is in second place. After the fifth dive, Dibiasi finally forges ahead. With one dive left, Dibiasi leads, followed by Louganis. Now Louganis' last dive. Louganis is well rewarded by the judges, but it is too late. Only a disastrous last dive can lose the gold medal for Klaus Dibiasi.
Now the only way Klaus was going to lose that championship was one with his, to have his hand slip off the end of the tower where he'd get completely zero, or lose his balance, and also duck his head on the entry.
Dibiasi is near perfect.
He got nines and nine and a half, which he should have gotten. But then the camera turned to me and you can see me in complete agony because there went the gold medal.
Klaus Dibiasi has won his third successive Olympic gold medal. In the history of platform diving, three gold medals have been awarded to Italy, and all three have been won by Klaus Dibiasi. This is Pat Keller McCormick of the United States. When it was announced that the Olympic Games would be held in London in 1948, after a 12-year hiatus because of World War II, 18-year-old Pat Keller tried out for the United States Olympic women's diving team. The following year, Pat Keller married her diving coach, Glenn McCormick.
In 1948, I tried out for my first Olympic team, and I missed it by 1/100th of a point. But I was very fortunate in meeting Vicky Draves and Sammy Lee, and these are former Olympic champions. And from that moment on, that's what I wanted to be. I was so thrilled just to be there, to be able to compete. But it was really a very motivating factor to me, because from that moment on, I knew I wanted to not go on to the next Olympics, but I knew I wanted to do something that no one has ever done, and that's to try to compete in two Olympics and win the double-double.
Helsinki, 1952, the opening day ceremonies of the Olympic Games. One of the members of the United States women's diving team, 22-year-old Pat McCormick. Pat McCormick will compete in both the springboard and platform diving events. In springboard diving, Pat McCormick will attempt to continue the unbeaten streak begun by American women divers 32 years earlier in Antwerp, when women's springboard diving was contested for the first time at the Olympic Games. Then it was won by 14-year-old Eileen Riggin of the United States.
Our swimming coach was an amateur, and we had no diving coach at all because this was somewhat of a new event. There was no one to follow. We just had to improvise as we went along. Before we were selected, we had a little difficulty. The person who selected the team reluctantly agreed to have women compete, and when they heard the children were going to try to go to the Olympic Games, they said they definitely would not be responsible for taking us to Europe, that it was just simply impossible. And we unpacked and cried, and finally, the day or two before we were to go, we had a telephone call, and they said, well, we've convinced them that you will be able to go on the team because you've won your places and you won them fairly, and it wouldn't be right to deny you.
Eileen Riggin's victory was the beginning of American women's dominance in springboard diving. In the next four Olympiads, American women controlled the event. At the 1936 Berlin Olympic Games, diver Marjorie Gestring of the United States won a double honor. She was awarded the gold medal and replaced Eileen Riggin as the youngest Olympic gold medalist. Marjorie Gestring was 13 years and 9 months old.
I'm awfully happy I won this championship, and I owe all my things that I've won from my coach, Fred Cady.
As Pat McCormick prepared for the 1952 Helsinki competition, she remembered the London Games 4 years before.
I can remember when Vicky Draves, who won the 1948 Olympics, came back, and at that time Vicky was never a springboard diver. But they asked her, I can remember being there, they asked her, Vicky, you know, how did you come up with this performance? And she said, Pat, she says, I just looked at my USA uniform. She says, I'd never represented anything so great.
Now here in Helsinki, Pat McCormick will attempt to give the United States women the gold medal in springboard diving for the seventh consecutive time.
52 was really fun. I can say it's like your first kiss. I never was exposed to the Olympics. It was a really big thrill. I felt when I was going to Helsinki that I was going to win. Although, at that time, Zoan Olsen, who was our top Olympic contender at 1948, came back out of retirement. So everybody figured out that she was going to win the next Olympics, and that just made me furious.
Here in Helsinki, Pat McCormick duplicated Vicky Drave's feat by winning both the springboard and platform diving events. She shared honors with America's Sammy Lee, who won his second successive gold medal in men's high diving.
When I first saw Pat McCormick dive, I said, oh boy, that gal will never make it. She couldn't point her toes. I said, you look like you got gaiters on or snowshoes in midair. I said, you can't straighten out your body. You always got a little batinsky in there. When we say straight, we mean straight. You always got a pike in your dive. But that girl, she worked so hard and she was so determined. That's what makes her great. She had determination and she was one tremendous competitor. I'm telling you, when she met a challenge, the only problem with Pat is if everybody dived lousy, Pat dived lousy. If everybody dived like an Olympic champion, Pat McCormick dived better. She's got that kind of a competitive instinct, and she's not going to let anybody beat her.
Melbourne, 1956. Pat McCormick will try to become the first diver in Olympic history to win successive gold medals in both the springboard and platform diving events. She and Glenn McCormick, her husband and coach, are now the parents of a small child. In preparation for the Melbourne Games, Pat McCormick's schedule never changes. 100 dives a day, 6 days a week, 12 months a year.
56, it was really tough because I really wanted to do something that no one had ever done, and that's by winning two double-doubles back-to-back. My husband was becoming a very prominent coach at that time and coaching all the other people to beat me. It was really a strange thing because here are all the kids that had made the team, especially on springboard. Two or three of the gals came out from the United States because they wanted to train with me, but there is a hero worship with a coach, you know. These gals really looked up to Glenn, and it was really difficult because here I was training for the Olympics myself. I had a small child, and I was fixing breakfast for them, and I thought to myself, hey, wait a minute, you know, I'm the star, supposedly. Something's got to be done about this. They should be helping me, just the idea of them coming out and staying with us and training with us.
17 women from 8 countries compete in the springboard diving event. Preparing for her 10th and last dive, Pat McCormick has an insurmountable lead. Pat McCormick wins her 3rd Olympic gold medal. Now it was time for the platform diving event and the opportunity for Pat McCormick to become the first diver, male or female, to win 4 gold medals.
I was going in the finals in about 4th place, and I had 2 dives left. And I'll never forget, riding back in the bus, I had tears in my eyes. The girl that was in 1st place was my teammate. I really had to make peace with myself, and I had to feel that whatever happened, I would be happy with the result. Well, I went into competition and I did 2 of the best dives I've ever done. I can relive this many, many times. You just can't imagine working so long for something and then finally achieving it. And then to cap it off by stepping up on those last 3 steps to that victory stand and then playing the Star Spangled Banner, wow.
Pat McCormick retired after the Melbourne Olympics.
I realized that I had won everything there is to win. I realized I wanted education, and it was just a great thrill for me, and especially hanging on another 4 years. I feel so privileged to have the opportunity to do this, to be able to compete another 4 years.
Pat McCormick, the only diver, male or female, to win successive gold medals in both the springboard and platform diving events. This is Harrison Dillard. He was born in Cleveland, Ohio, and he lives and works there today. When Jesse Owens won 4 gold medals at the 1936 Berlin Olympic Games, Harrison Dillard was 13 years old. It was then that Harrison Dillard dreamed of competing in the Olympic Games.
I can remember very vividly, of course, Jesse Owens, who was from Cleveland. And that year, 1936 specifically, when Jesse came back home to Cleveland after going to the parade in New York and up Fifth Avenue with a ticker tape job, they had a parade for him here in Cleveland. And I remember after the parade passed, we ran back home. And I burst into the kitchen and said, "Mama, Mama, I just saw Jesse Owens. I'm going to be just like him." And she said, "Yes, son, I'm sure you will."
London, 1948. The Olympic Games are renewed for the first time since the Berlin Games of 1936. One of the members of the United States team, 25-year-old Harrison Dillard. Dillard served in World War II after attending Baldwin Wallace College, where he excelled as one of America's outstanding hurdlers and sprinters. In track circles, he is called Bones, a nickname that has stayed with him from childhood because of his slight build. In the months before the London Olympic Games, Dillard had an incredible streak of 82 consecutive victories in the hurdles and sprints. His unbeaten streak was still intact when he entered the United States Olympic trials. Dillard would try to make the team in more than one event.
The Olympic coach had thought that I would be fast enough to make the sprint relay team, the 400-meter relay. So on that basis, I elected to try to qualify in the 100 on Friday. Barney Ewell, who equaled, I think, the world record in that race, Barney had a beautiful start. Mel Patton and I were just running to make the team, really. And we were the last two starters, last two men out of the blocks. And we passed everybody except Barney. So the three of us, Ewell, Patton, Dillard, were the three American sprinters in the 100.
The day after the 100-meter trials, the trials for the 110-meter hurdles are held. Harrison Dillard is the unanimous favorite to win this event and then go on to win the Olympic gold medal.
Well, this, of course, was to be an event in which I had again but to place no worse than third. I got over the first hurdle, as I recall, in pretty good shape, but I think I hit about second, third, fourth, fifth hurdles just consecutively with my heel, the lead heel, going up. And finally, I wound up at the eighth hurdle, just the timing, the rhythm so completely destroyed that I just stopped at that point, of course, dead last. The first time I remember ever having finished last in a race, and of all races to do it in, it had to be the Olympic qualifying race.
Dillard made the sprint team with his third place finish behind Mel Patton and Barney Ewell. A few days before the qualifying round for the London Olympic 100 meters, Dillard had a talk with Barney Ewell.
Barney was also my roommate. Actually, there were four of us in a room, a big room. And he had the cot or the bed next to mine. And on the Wednesday, before we were to run, I was sitting there, and this was actually the truth. I wasn't just saying it to psych Barney. I actually envisioned myself winning the final race on Saturday. And I told Barney that. I said, "Barney, I'm going to beat you on Saturday." I said, "I don't care what you do, I'm going to beat you. I've seen it, I feel it." And he just kind of laughed.
Even though Harrison Dillard had won all his preliminaries, the favorites in the race are still Mel Patton closest to the camera, Barney Ewell beside him in lane two, and Lloyd LaBeach of Panama, lane three. Dillard is at the top on the far outside in lane six. Dillard, on the extreme left, is out fastest of all. Ewell, second from the right, is a few feet behind him.
We got down to about 50 meters, roughly halfway in the race, and I was perhaps 5 or 6 feet ahead, which I think was a phenomenal lead considering the caliber of the competition. And I was not about to stop and try to figure out, well, how did I get this far in front of these kind of guys? So I took the last few strides, I lunged for the tape, And I felt it strike me high across the chest. At the same time, somebody else is doing the same thing. There's another white jersey down there. And it turned out to be my roommate and my teammate, Barney Ewell. Barney went into a victory dance or started jumping up and down. And I think that this was partly due to the fact that back here in the States, of course, this was before the photoelectrical timing systems became universal. And you just had judges looking, making decisions as to who had won and who had placed where. And so if the athlete acted as if he had won in a tight, close race, perhaps it might influence a judge almost unconsciously. And I remember Lloyd LeBeach from Panama. As I remember, Lloyd was in either third or fourth lane. He was between Barney and me in terms of lane assignment. And Lloyd finished fourth, so he was just back a ways, but in a perfect position to see. And I remember when the race ended and Barney was jumping up and down, and Lloyd saying to Barney, "Man, you don't win the race." He said, "Bones win. I see, Bones win." And sure enough, when they made the announcement, the Bones did win. And that's so I got the gold medal.
Harrison Dillard first, Barney Ewell second, Lloyd LeBeach third. In a few days, Dillard and Ewell will join Lorenzo Wright and Mel Patton on the heavily favored United States 4x100 relay team. Ewell, on the extreme right, leads off. Lorenzo Wright, in the middle, awaits Ewell's pass-off. Because of the staggered lanes, it is difficult to see who is in front. The third leg begins. Harrison Dillard, closest to the camera, has a 4-yard lead. Mel Patton takes the final pass off from Harrison Dillard. As Patton moves towards the finish line, a British official observing the pass off from Ewell to Wright is already moving to the judges' stand to file a protest. Barney Ewell remembers the scene.
And we wonder why it took so long for him to announce the winner. So they finally made an announcement that the United States team was disqualified. So our hearts sunk. And we wondered just what went wrong.
The judge who watched the first changeover between our first two runners thought that we had gone out of the baton passing zone. And on that basis, he disqualified us. Well, Barney, the leadoff man, his great experience, insisted that he had not gone out of the zone before giving the stick to Wright. On that basis, Barney's word, primarily, a protest was lodged and filed with the Olympic Committee. And they agreed to review the protest. They studied the films, and it showed very clearly that the judge had made apparently was an honest mistake.
72 hours after the race, the United States relay team is officially recognized as the winner of the race. Harrison Dillard has won his second Olympic gold medal.
But incidentally, the mistake, the judge who made the mistake, we found out later, was a Scotch Presbyterian minister. So, of course, we had no reason to question the man's honesty. It had to be an honest mistake.
Helsinki, 1952. The nations of the world again march in the opening day ceremonies of the Olympic Games. 29-year-old Harrison Dillard will again compete in two events. This time he qualifies in his specialty, the 110-meter hurdles. He will also run the second leg on the United States 4x100 relay team. His main opposition in the hurdles is expected to come from his teammate Jack Davis.
Jack Davis was obviously going to be the toughest competition for me. Jack from Southern Cal, a big strapping, strong hurdler. He was a real hard-nosed competitor. I think this was one of the things that made him such a good hurdler, that he had absolutely no fear of a hurdle. He just attacked it as you're supposed to do. And the only thing I think that hurdlers worry about is hitting the hurdles, banging them to the extent that, as it had happened to me in 1948, that your timing and your rhythm is just so totally destroyed that you lose your speed.
Jack Davis is at the extreme right. Dillard, fourth from the right.
I had a beautiful start, led by inches going over the first hurdle, gradually lengthened the lead until about the fifth or sixth hurdle. And I saw this big foot come up beside me. You know, Jack was about 6 foot three, 6 3 and a half, as opposed to my little puny 5 feet 10. With each succeeding hurdle, I could see more, and finally that big head and everything else, he was all there. And just a question now of, can I hold him off?
Harrison Dillard first, Jack Davis second, Arthur Barnard, United States, third. The finish is so close. Both Dillard and Davis are given the identical time of 13 and 7/10 seconds. Harrison Dillard has won his third Olympic gold medal. On the final day, the 4x100 relay is held. Dillard will run the second leg. Dillard, on the extreme right, takes the pass from Dean Smith. Because of the staggered lanes, it is difficult to see the leader. But Dillard has given Lindy Remigino of the United States a 3-meter lead. Remigino, closest to the camera, passes off to Andy Stanfield. United States first, the Soviet Union second, Hungary third. Harrison Dillard's Olympic career is now over. He has equaled the record of his boyhood idol, Jesse Owens. 4 gold medals. And now that it is over, what moments would Harrison Dillard want to relive?
I think the first one, simply because it was first, winning the gold medal after not having been able to qualify and win in the hurdles was the culmination of a dream that I'd had for over a dozen years. And when I mounted that victory stand, I can remember, I'll never forget, seeing the flag go up, hearing the national anthem played, and feeling the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I remember just feeling so very proud that I, a young black man from Cleveland, was able to stand there and cause the anthem to be played and the flag to be raised because of an effort on my part. It was just a fantastic feeling.